So there's a video from GreatScott where he makes a standalone computer monitor from an LCD panel of a laptop, and I'm thinking I'd like to try the same. I do already have another monitor, and I rarely use the thing, so if I'm going to make another one, it needs to have a greater purpose. Turns out I have the same LCD panel as GreatScott. I also noticed the controller board he used operates in 12 volts and has a connection for a built-in speaker. Because of that, I decided to try and make a tripod mounted viewfinder. It'd pretty much be a portable monitor with a battery and speakers built into it. It independently tilt and swivel while mounted on my tripod so that it could display the output of my camera from any angle. This would be nice for times like right now where I'm standing in front of the camera with nobody behind it. I often have to make test videos to make sure that my head's in focus and not cut off, which gets old. And finally, I thought I could try and do this on as small of a budget as possible. I've never done something like this before, so it could be a challenge. With that being said, let's get started. I removed the screen from my dead laptop and make sure the controller board I ordered will work. The keypad, inverter, and LVDS cables that came with the board all fit in their appropriate connections. And even though I didn't film it, connecting a power and signal source does make the screen turn on and display an image. The only decent speakers I have lying around are these ones from my old broken TV. They're bigger than I'm wanting, but they'll do. I bought the battery and a charger from Batteries Plus. It is a huge battery, but if I'm really going to use this in the field, I don't want it dying on me. It sort of defeats the purpose when it does that. With the basics taken care of, I focus on the tilting swiveling bracket that will bolt to the tripod. I console my scrap pile and make my grinder my best friend throughout this project. With the cutoff wheel, I cut out a piece of metal while my vise holds it in place, then clean up the jagged edges with the grinder and some emery cloth. I then drill a pilot hole in one corner, followed by a 3/8-inch bit, and sand it smooth. I measure this hole so it matches up with the 3/8 threaded hole that's already on my tripod. It seemed like it'd be too flimsy, so I pop riveted this piece of aluminum to the backside. I then consult this old grill for material and remove this cross member by any means necessary. After I have this piece of square tubing, I go back to the first piece of metal and start to cut out some L-shaped pieces that are the same width as the tubing. These pieces will fit up against the end of the tubing and make a riser of sorts, which I then pop rivet to the ends of the tube. I now jump back to the very first piece I cut out and drill a 3/8-inch hole in the center of one end. I mark the center of my tube and drill a 3/8-inch hole all the way through. I then sand the edges of both holes smooth. I run a 3/8-inch bolt through the holes and create the swiveling part of my mounting bracket. The risers on each end of the tube will bolt into the screen's frame that I'll be making later. This bolt is clearly way too long, and since I didn't want to drive across town just to buy a shorter bolt, I cut it short around the edges with my grinder. If I do this right, I can put the nut back on with relative ease. I use three washers with this bolt. I sandwich a really large washer between the tube and the angled piece underneath. This helps it swivel more smoothly, and the lock nut underneath holds it all together. I need a frame of sorts to hold the screen in place, so I went with this piece of metal because it's large, thin, and has lots of right angles that I need. To say the least, I took a lot of measurements and did a lot of grinding. I ended up with two pieces that ran along the sides of the screen with arms that went alongside the top and bottom of the screen. I then cut out some plexiglass at the same dimensions as the screen. This will be a protective barrier, seeing how this thing will sometimes be outside in the elements. I'm glad I thought to do this when I did because it sets the screen about an 1/8 inch deeper into the frame. I want to make sure I correctly drill the small holes for the mounting screws to go through. If I'm off even by a little, it can really mess things up. I take the hinges from the laptop that also screwed into the screen, and I cut the hinge part off. I screw the R part onto the screen, making sure the plexiglass is underneath. Then I'll hold the frame piece I made against the side screen and trace the original bracket. I then remove the original brackets from the screen and clamp them onto the piece I made, making sure they're fit inside their traced outline. I now have a template clamped to my project and know exactly where to drill my holes. I had these handles from an old server and thought they could be nice to have on this project. However, when this part fits up against the side of the frame, the handle hangs over the front of the screen just a little bit. I need to give myself some room for the plexiglass and faceplate to fit up underneath the lip on the handle. It's challenging to figure out how much space to give myself because the outside part of the faceplate is thicker than the inside, and it's the inside thickness that I need to know. So I flip the faceplate over so the inside of it is against the outside edge of the screen. There's a lip on either side of the handle, and I decide that the side with the lower lip will be on the outside. I then set the handle where it needs to go and use the speaker to hold it in place, since the speaker's magnet is attracted to the steel plate in the table saw. I then clamp the handle to the frame and remove the faceplate, plexiglass, and screen. I can now drill holes for pop rivets, and later I repeated this process for the other side. To me, it makes the most sense to have the speaker's face out the sides, so I trace around the cardboard edge of the speaker and again around the outermost edge. This makes two sets of marks on the frame to show how much I need to cut out. As long as I cut between these two sets of lines, the speaker should fit into the space I cut out but not fall through it. With that taken care of, I take a minute to make something for the controller board to mount to. I cut out this piece of metal that has an angle on one end. I pop rivet it to a bottom arm and the side of the frame. I then cut a large notch out of a piece of angle so that it can fit around a speaker, like so. This piece pop rivets onto the side and will give something for the backside to mount to. Since I made the handles overhang in front of the screen a little bit, the screen can't be removed from the front. To remedy this, I drill out the rivets that hold the handles in place and replace them with 8/32 bolts.
I also drill holes for bolts that will mount the speakers in place. Now that the handles can be removed, the screen can be installed or uninstalled through the front. This gives me a lot more freedom in reinforcing the whole frame. I console my old grill and extract another piece of square tubing. I clean the edges and cut up the same length as the screen. I then pop rivet it to the top back side of my frame. Moving on, I see that I need to fill this gap on the bottom, but still allows space for the controller board's buttons to be installed.
So I chop up another scrap piece and do my best to make the angle parts towards the back flush with the two pieces around the speakers. I then clamp it in place and pop rivet it to the frame.
Next, I mark where the mounting holes for the controller board will meet up with the frame and then drill them out. I cut out a piece from a sheet of packaging foam and use a hole punch to make holes where the mounting bolts will run through. This gives me some padding and insulation between the board and the metal frame. I use spacers made from the tube part of a pen to give me something for the bolts to tighten against without smashing the board into the foam. I then focus on making a battery holder and say that I need to fix a small problem. I remove the tubing from the top back part of my project and move it so it's right above the controller board. I do this because the only other tubing I have is too big to be right above the controller board, but still small enough to fit in the top back part. I then cut out a larger piece of tubing for my grill's leg and put it in place of the smaller one that was there before. The point is to make a sturdy frame that can house the heavy battery. Out of more scrap pieces, I cut out an angle piece that bridges the two pieces of tubing. I notch out both ends so they can lay flush with surrounding pieces, and then make a second one. I cut out another piece that hangs from the previous one. I'm careful to make it so that it has a little bit of a gap between it and the screen. This will support the weight of the battery whenever the screen is facing down instead of the screen taking the brunt of it. I make another piece for the other side and a thin bar that connects the two together. I then apply double stick tape to the edge facing the screen and stick on some soft cloth just to give some padding behind the screen. I center the whole thing with my project and pop rivet it in. I turn my focus toward the faceplate. I install a piece to tie the top arms together into the large tubing. Here I've assembled the screen enough so that my camera can be displayed through it. As it turns out, where the metal border ends on the screen is not where the pixels start. There's actually a gap the faceplate usually covers that can't be seen unless the screen is displaying something. Having it turned on helps me determine where to attach the faceplate so that there are no gaps or crop portions in my picture. I drill out holes and thread them with an 8/32 tap. I pretty much just drill a hole, thread it, install a screw, and drill the next one until my faceplate is secured. Next, I take the plastic buttons from my broken TV and fill in the hollow backside with hot glue. This is so that you can place a button right over the board and it would work properly. I then reattach the faceplate and hold the button board against the underside so I can mark where each button will be. I then use a drill bit gauge to determine the size of hole needed for each button, then drill those holes at the marks on the faceplate. I then mark where two mounting holes are and drill those into the faceplate. I also install a piece of clear plastic from the TV's IR sensor in front of the LED. I cut two more spacers out of pen tubing and use them to space the button board from the faceplate. I use 6/32 bolts and nuts to hold it together. Next, I mark out some notches in the sides of the faceplate so that it won't interfere with the handles, and then very safely use my grinder to cut them out. Jumping back to the tilt swivel bracket, I mark and drill holes for bolts to go through and into the screen portion. I then drill out receiving holes on each side of the frame. I screw my eye hook bolt into the side and use a T-nut to hold in place. The T-nut has flat flanges that allow me to pop rivet into the frame, and thus giving the bolts something solid to screw into. Next, I use the top panel from the laptop as my back panel. I TDC clamp, measure, and reclamp the panel to the frame, making sure it squares up with everything else as much as it can, and particularly making sure it can clear the tilt swivel bracket when it tilts back. Next, I drill, thread holes, and install screws. I need to make some custom holes for all the ports on the controller board to poke through, so I install the board and screw the panel on over it. I do my best to trace every port from the inside and then use a small triangular shaped file to shape all the holes. The port holes are finished, so I file out a hole on the other side for the charging port. I use my utility knife to clean it up and the charger port fits in snugly. I want to be able to easily and completely remove the back panel, so I use a 4-pin power supply connector for the charging port and power switch. Whenever I pull the cover off, I can unplug the charging port and power switch from the rest of the assembly. To help against rust, I paint the whole frame before putting everything together. Now it's time to finish the sides. I start by cutting out the plastic speaker covering from the back panel of my TV. I use my table saw to square them up into something useful. I then cut some thin foam to fit in between the speakers and their covers. This will help against dust and other outside elements. For the top and bottom, I make some fillers by cutting layers of 1/8-inch particle board. The first layer has notches and holes in it to accommodate room for pop rivet heads. I then glue the layers together and cut out the finishing layer out of some laminate wood salvaged from a drawer. I glue the filler pieces to the finish piece.
I make a few more pieces like this to fill in the top as well as the sides above and below the speakers.
The wiring is pretty simple, yet tedious to do. A wire leading to the battery's positive terminal runs through a 5-amp fuse before going through the 4-pin connector and to the middle terminal on the switch. The switch has three positions, with the middle one being off. Flipping the switch down will put the device in charge mode. This connects the battery's positive terminal to the inside prong of this barrel jack, which my charger can plug into. The cylindrical part of the jack connects to the negative terminal. While it's in this mode, the battery can't power the controller board. This means that while the battery is being charged on its own circuit, the screen could be powered from a different source through the controller board's barrel jack. Flipping the switch up will let the power flow through this low voltage disconnect module, which prevents the battery from being over discharged. It acts as a switch that simply cuts the power when the voltage becomes too low. In this case, the cutoff is at 10.5 volts. I'll then reconnect after the voltage is brought up to 11.1 volts. Two wires run from the output end of this module and solder to the barrel jack on the controller board so that the board can be powered internally. From there, a ribbon cable runs to the keypad, while the inverter and LVDS cables merge to plug into the LCD panel. And finally are the wires that run to the speakers. I mount it to my tripod and use my HDMI A to HDMI C cable to connect my camera to the viewfinder. If I turn the camera on before the viewfinder, it'll automatically switch to the active video source. If there's more than one, I can always use the keypad to pick which source. And just like a regular monitor, I can adjust picture settings and put it in standby mode, although I normally use the switch in the back. As expected, this thing will display any video source that can plug into it, and the battery can last 8 consecutive hours in one charge. I've also modified this car adapter should it happen to die while away from any outlets. With a 5-amp fuse inside, it can power the device, or even charge it when the car is running.
Yeah, so that basically does it. I'd like to thank y'all for watching, and if there's any way you thought you could make this better, let me know in the comments. And feel free to check out my other videos as well. Thanks for watching. Have a great day. Because I bought this LCD screen, and I have an LCD screen from an old laptop, and then essentially turns it into a... I know where to point it exactly because the screen would be like right above the camera and I can just look at the screen and set up a shot. How about?
Did you pee? Pee? Oh, thank you for the wrench.
Are you afraid to walk on the floor barefoot?